dissociative identity disorder with Dr. Richard Day. What is dissociative identity disorder, also known as DID?
It's better known under the name it held for most of its lifetime, multiple personality disorder. It's essentially a disorder in which the primary symptomatology is individuals losing track of periods of time. It's a very controversial disorder category, probably the most controversial in the entire DSM. But it involves separate personality states taking charge of the individual's behavior and cognition at different times and in different circumstances. That's the primary set of symptoms we see in DID. There are a lot of things that go along with that, but that's basically it.
Is there a specific reason why the name was changed from multiple personality disorder?
Yes, there is a reason. The main reason is that it became apparent that these weren't entire whole personalities, right? So multiple personality didn't make sense. So that's why they called it identity disorder. The individual, the alters, the alternative pieces, if you like, of the individual's personality are partial personalities, if you like. They tend to encapsulate certain kinds of emotional reactions to certain supposed events in the individual's past, but they don't reflect the entirety of the individual's personality or experience. So they're identity fragments, really, which is why the name was changed.
What causes DID?
Well, how much time have we got? The short answer to that is we don't know. The longer answer is the primary hypothesis about it is, well, there are two, actually, primary hypotheses. One, and this is the dominant one that governs treatment options in DID, is that it's a reaction to inappropriate traumatic events early in the individual's life, typically in childhood. And the specific kind of trauma that's usually pointed to is childhood sexual abuse. A very high proportion of individuals who have received the diagnostic label DID do report, under varying circumstances, that they did experience or they recall having experienced some sort of sexual trauma early in life, incest, for example. A second hypothesis, which competes with the first, is that it isn't a real disorder at all. That in fact the symptoms are, if you like, created through suggestive treatment approaches by psychiatrists and clinical psychologists. Because in the majority, I'd say, of cases, the alters, the various personality identity fragments that are uncovered in therapy under hypnosis. And of course, the problem with hypnosis, as we know, is the individual is by definition highly suggestible. You can get people to recall almost anything under hypnosis if you suggest it strongly enough. Previous lives, life in the womb, doesn't really seem to matter. And so the alternative to the trauma dissociation model, which is the main treatment approach, is that this is really not a disorder that exists in the wild in nature, or at least not very, very, very frequently. Instead, it's something that's created by well-meaning but suggestive therapeutic techniques in the treatment situation. And in fact, there was a study done, published in 2015, looking at all of the new cases of DID that were reported between 2000 and 2010, right? So a 10-year period. About 1,200 brand new cases of DID were identified in that period of time. 97% of them were identified during therapy. Only 3% were identified outside therapy. And we have to understand also that most people who receive eventually the diagnostic label DID don't come in complaining of the symptoms of DID. They come in for headache, they come in for memory loss, they come in for marital discord, a whole raft of different things. And then for some reason or other, it is suggested to them that maybe they suffered childhood abuse and maybe they've got memories that they haven't recovered, and that may lead in some cases to a diagnosis of DID.
Does DID typically manifest itself with a particular number or range of personalities?
That's an interesting question. I guess the appropriate answer is not really. If you look at the early cases, that is up to say 1975 or so, and between, let's say, 1800 and 1965, there were only about 75 cases in the entire world that had been reported. But then there were a couple of publications, a couple of books, Sybil, Three Faces of Eve, which is made into a movie, as a matter of fact. And suddenly we began to get a much more frequent diagnosis of MPD then and DID now. And if you look at the early cases, they're typically two or three alters plus the host personality. Today, the average is something like 10 or 12. And I recall reading a case where the eager therapist had managed to uncover 1,000 alters. That was after the 500 he first diagnosed had split into two, each of them. You know, so what does it make? How does anybody have enough of a life for 1,000 personalities? It simply doesn't make any sense at all. So it's hard to answer the question, but something like 10 or 15 would be a typical number these days.
Is there a cure or current therapeutics that target symptomatology?
Cure is a tough word. There is a typical treatment. It varies in the way it's delivered by different therapists, but essentially it involves trying in various ways to reintegrate all of the various fragments back into the host personality. In a significant fraction of the reported cases, that treatment has been successful, but they haven't really been tested adequately, those models of treatment. So it's hard to know really what is going on in the treatment options there. As I said, the treatments are delivered differently by different therapists. There may be different standards for diagnosis. There are a whole raft of reasons that we're not really sure whether that's the best approach, because there hasn't been any alternative really that's been tested in the literature at all.
Are there any sociocultural differences or influences?
Sociocultural differences. Well, I can only say that that study I mentioned that looked at the roughly 1,000 new cases between 2000 and 2010, something like 80% of them were in Europe and North America. And of those, 50% were in the United States. The only significant area where there was a significant number of initial cases diagnosed was actually Turkey, of all places. Virtually nowhere else in the world do we get any significant number of cases diagnosed, which leads a lot of critics to wonder about the diagnostic category itself.
Can DID patients lead normal lives?
DID patients often do lead normal lives, as a matter of fact, even with the disorder, because they're functioning. It's just that different aspects of their personality, if you like, if you believe in the disorder, come to the fore under certain life circumstances. If you're having a conflict with a fellow worker, one side of your personality may show up. In an intimate relationship with the family, another side of the personality or the host may be present. So by and large, yes, they do tend to lead relatively normal lives. Some of the patients whose cases have been described actually have very substantial professional jobs, as a matter of fact, and were still functioning reasonably well.
Are you interested in the portrayal of DID in the movie Split? If so, click on the link below to continue this dissociative identity disorder discussion with Dr. Day.